Okay. Good morning, everybody. Nice to see you. Nice to see a full room talking about SQL Server. That's a really good thing. We're talking about SQL Server 2014 feature drilldown. Myself and Dandy here. So I'm going to introduce Dandy for you. Dandy's a senior product manager from Corp, from Redmond. He's been doing this particular session in a number of different locations. He's just done it in Australia, so we're really lucky, really glad that he's here. So please make him welcome. I'm sure you will. He's a certified master, and he's been involved with SQL.
That's a lot of pressure.
For a long time.
What are you doing?
So just talking you up there. All right.
Okay. So, thanks, everyone, for having me over.
There we go. So thanks everyone for having me over. It's a great opportunity to be here. It's my first time to New Zealand, and I figured the weather is kind of similar to what we have in Seattle. So, and we have water and mountains and things like that as well. And I'm really happy to see that we have a packed room. So how about we get it started, Pat?
Okay. Let's talk a little bit about evolution of SQL Server over time. Hands up, anybody here that's been involved with SQL Server from, let's say, 4.2? Two people, four people, 6.5? Whoa, that's impressive. Okay, we'll leave it there.
So the interesting take there, if you look at yourself on where you are now from when you started with SQL Server, you see things that evolved. I mean, me personally, I gained about 20 kilos ever since. But there's a lot of evolvement that we actually put in the product, and basically the key features and enhancements as we continue to evolve the SQL Server database platform is because of technologies, not only that are necessary because the market is changing and we have a huge amount of data. We want to provide insights on those data, but also primarily because of customer demand. Okay? If you are demanding mission-critical systems, and you want to use SQL Server for that, we started building that out with SQL 2000, and we continue to evolve that with 2005, 2008, 2008 R2, which I assume a lot of people are using what we call database mirroring. And then we made enhancements on that with SQL Server 2012 and SQL Server 2014. We actually continued in that entire motion on providing those capabilities. And one of the things that we have there is also our BI capabilities, where in SQL Server 2012 we talked about column store, and today we're going to talk about how we evolve that column store to the next versions.
Right, and we're also going to talk, of course, about SQL 14. We see a brief potted summary here of some of the topics that we're going to talk about, but it's quite a nice slide just showing you how the products evolved over time and where significant features, where they fit. All right, so let's move through.
So if we look on the key pillars, as we call it, on how we architected SQL Server 2014, we talk more about SQL Server just more than just a database. We talk about a pure data platform in which one of the key pillars that we've targeted on with our engineering department is making sure we bring you mission-critical performance. We actually had capabilities in 2012, 2008 R2, with database mirroring, always on availability groups. What we focused on with SQL Server 2014 is how can we make that better, faster failover, and more levels of failover. If we then look on the growth that we see in data expansions across multiple companies where data now needs to be, So I'll mix it up probably. So you see that it comes from multiple sources. It doesn't really sit only in SQL Server. It might be sitting on Facebook. You might be pulling that in from Twitter. So the social aspect to that is key. Or it might be running on HDFS or HD Insight, which is the Microsoft Hadoop distribution that we have running on Windows Azure.
Indeed.
From a cloud perspective, the SQL Server 2012 pillars that we talked about was a pillar that we called Cloud on Your Terms. That has not changed. It is still on your terms. And I guess there's a lot of DBAs and database developers in the room here, or architects. you should design your solutions with thinking about those capabilities that we'll talk about today, and I have a session on that tomorrow as well, on how you could leverage those opportunities, not only from a cloud perspective, but also from a mission critical, a performance, a disaster recovery perspective, or even a backup perspective to that point. So the mission critical capabilities, there's a lot of players out there in the market that actually talk about in-memory features or in-memory capabilities, and you see some players coming up in the in-memory database. Now, if I were to ask you to raise your hand on how many of you know SQL Server, I would expect I see the majority of the hands going up, right? How about you raise your hands? I just want to see. Okay. So, yeah, the majority know SQL Server, right? It's a database. We use that for relational purposes. Probably when you talk about some of the advanced features, if I were to ask and drill down this, how many of you know how to partition tables, work with file groups, and so on? Okay. Those hands will probably still continue to be up. When I started with databases, and then I think that's why Pat asked, like, who started with SQL 4.2 or even earlier, I started with a product called DBase. Quite honestly, I haven't done anything different than continuing to build up on my capabilities and database technologies. I mean, if you know index optimization, you could continue to take that further. If you know how to write a join, you could continue to take that further. With any feature that we put in SQL Server, it's not going to be any different but that. Okay? If you know SQL Server, you know in memory because we put it inside the database engine. It's not a new product. It's a pure in-memory engine that we put in there. And the same thing is with our advanced capabilities on high availability, enhancements that we do in security, and the same level of mission critical support that we provide you with that. So you see a lot of things evolve on things that you all... Are we out of time?
Eggs. It's the eggs.
Oh, yeah. Oh, that's the egg timer. So anyone? We got some fresh hard-boiled eggs here. So if you want, if anyone wants to grab those, I think you didn't get breakfast yet, did you? Well, you should take them. We got coffee here too, by the way. So yeah, those in-memory capabilities continue to enhance, and Pat is going to talk us through that and actually going to show us those capabilities and what is in it for you, without making any major changes to your applications or anything like that.
Okay, so let me talk a little bit about that. We will have heard, I think most folks will have heard of the internal project code of Hackathon, that's in-memory OLTP. So this is a significant change to the SQL Server engine. It's really an optimistic locking mechanism, using a version store that's in memory rather than in tempdb. Very, very fast. We'll see a demo of that working. The primary benefits through not taking latches, not taking latch contention, not taking shared locks on pages. So very, very fast in-memory engine. We've got a good case study here from BWIN. We can see here the kinds of benefits and the kind of gains that particular application has made by using this in-memory OLTP technology. Dandy, I believe this is
So BWIN is a gambling company, and we happen to be in a casino, right? If I think about this, what they do with their gaming applications and online gaming applications, they would get traditionally 15,000 requests per second, translating into multiple transactions and so on. Now on the same hardware with SQL Server 2014, leveraging those in-memory capabilities, they actually get 250,000 requests per second. Okay? I always think about that as like, what if that would be a dollar amount, right? I can process a much bigger amount of dollars onto the same hardware without making any major changes to my applications and continue to leverage and know what I already know about SQL Server. And of course, we continue to enhance that not only from an in-memory engine, we also want to bring that optimization into any kind of workload. So I know some of you work with Power Pivot. We continue to enhance Power Pivot capabilities. I know some of you already worked with Column Store and SQL Server 2012. We're actually going to show you on how that's going to look like in SQL Server 2014. And then one of the other in-memory capabilities is we're actually expanding the buffer cache to SSD. So you can really create a scenario where you have your hot data, which is primarily going to be sitting into buffer cache because you're hitting that data anyways. And then you have that additional tier of cache that's going to be sitting on a flash drive or it's going to be sitting on SSD before you actually access the data that is probably stored in index pages or data pages at that point. Okay. How about you show us that?
Let's do that. Maybe you can switch us over there.
I will switch you over to number one. And we'll go right there.
Okay. So let's have a look at this hackathon demo application. So what we see here is a baseline, an airline ticket reservation system driving the CPU very, very hard. Lots of transactions, as many transactions as we can push through in the capability of hardware that we have. And just very quickly, Dandy, can you talk us briefly, tell us about the configuration of this laptop?
The hardware is my laptop. That's all I have to say. It's the biggest thing I was potentially able to take with me and carry on luggage on the plane.
And the reason I ask that is I know that my manager's in the room and I've been trying to get more RAM for my laptop. So if you like the session and you want to help me out with this particular challenge, that would be great.
On that note, Pat's laptop is faster than mine. Okay.
All right, so let me talk you through this. So we have transactions per second. We're seeing around about 2,000 transactions per second, and we're seeing the CPU at 50-55%. But what you should notice, what you should think about, is the number of latches per second that you're seeing. Because when you drive the CPU hard, when you're moving lots of data in and out of the buffer pool, SQL has to take something called latches to physically protect pages as they move in and out of the buffer pool. And that's a CPU cost. So as you run the CPU higher, you're going to have a cost in terms of the number of latches. So what we're actually going to do now is we're going to migrate that system from a standard table to an in-memory table.
So what we'll do is we'll post you the script. I'll put that out on my blog and what we actually do there. And it's fairly simple. Okay. What happens behind the scene with this application is you are altering the database and adding a file group. And that file group is what we call a memory optimized file group. Now the key benefit of that memory optimized file group is that I can move that table to that memory optimized file group. And from that point, we go so much further than what a lot of the so-called in-memory database vendors do. Right? They still get stuck to the same transactional logging mechanisms. We get rid of that, okay? So we totally change that. Now the great thing about this, at this point, I do an alter table statement, and anyone knows how to create a table. So my create table statement is actually going to look as create table with a memory optimized clause and then specify the file group that it's gonna reside on. Now the great thing about this is this will give you full interop with any other table that you don't have sitting in memory, okay? So we talk about hackathon being in memory, so in memory OLTP, but you decide on what's going into memory, and one of the capabilities that we bring there is actually, how many of you are familiar with our management data warehouse, where you can do some reporting and such? What we're actually do is we're expanding that and actually allowing you to run a report against the tables that will most likely take the best advantage of in-memory components. Okay. And there's only so much we can put into a session, so I'm going to put you out to some additional links on how you could drill down into that and actually start using those capabilities. But it's a fairly straightforward process.
Okay, so let me drive on from that. So we've now changed this table to be an in-memory table. And what we'll see is a change in terms of the number of transactions per second that we push through. But what I would like you to focus on is what's happened to the latches per second, because we don't take latches in in-memory OLTP. So that CPU all gets given back. And now we can drive the CPU high and not spend time spinning protection mechanisms in the code. And you already see here, just by making the changes that Dandy just referenced, which is a DDL change, it's not a difficult change to make, we see the difference here between 2 and maybe 6,000 transactions per second.
And since that CPU went up so significantly, we could boil eggs on stage as we showed you before, right? So now the other step, and let's pause this one for a second there. What else we can do is, one of the features that we said is, hey, we want to go even further. And so what we're doing is, we allow you to natively compile your stored procedures into machine code. Which means, wow, that's fast. No more parsing, no more calculations, okay? So we actually compile a stored procedure into a native compiled stored procedure that you could then start using on that in-memory component. And that's where you're going to see the most significant growth, still on the same hardware, still with the same data that you were working with, still with the same capabilities that you were used to. So let's have a look on what happens when we actually migrate and compile that stored procedure. Okay. So I do my stored procedure compilation. Let's now hit start and see on how much faster my transactions are going.
So let's see what we're seeing here. This is quite a significant jump. Okay.
Now, let's talk about this. What we see with customer scenarios is we're actually getting performance increase that go 10 times faster, 50 times faster on exactly the same hardware. The reason why you only see between 10 and 12% on mine is because I am actually running that into a virtual machine on my demo laptop that has 32 gigs of RAM and quad-core CPU. Okay? It's quite impressive, isn't it? If you feel like giving an applause on any of those features, I bet the folks that will look at the recording will absolutely like this. So. Okay. Whew. Our first demo worked. That's pretty awesome. What else we got? Let's switch back to the presentation real quick here. Okay, there we go. So for the purposes of the presentation that you probably will be downloading, it's main memory optimized. The key reason we're doing this is because the cost of memory has gone down significantly. You have many more cores per CPU nowadays. And as we showed you, we actually can compile T-SQL into machine code. And it's fully integrated with SQL Server. So everything that you already know, that you're already well aware of, is just there and ready for you to use. Okay.
And just to repeat for my managers, as Dandy just said, the cost of memory has gone down significantly. We heard that here, right?
If he says that one more time, I'm going to send him to go get a cup of coffee with his manager. So, yeah, we showed you that OLTP capabilities. Now, what else have we done is we made significant enhancements on column store indexing. And so what we did is column store indexing in SQL 2012 will already give you faster performance. How many of you have used that? Has anyone played around with that yet? Okay, so a few hands. Now, if I use column store in SQL Server 2012, that will be created as a non-clustered column store index. Okay? And rather than talking about that on a slide, I'm actually going to show you how that works as well. So we're going to go back to our demo machine here, and we're going to look at something that I guess some of you absolutely like, which is SQL Server reporting services. Okay. Now what I have here is I'm going to run a report, and that report is going to run a while. Okay, you've seen this before. I think in China they call us the
Wheel of Life.
The Wheel of Life. Okay, so if you can make that faster, you could just live your life much faster, which brings lots of excitement, right? Now, I don't know how long my report will run. Typical scenario, my report went fine, and now it seems to take forever.
Does the demo stay like this, Tandy?
I have no idea on how long this is going to run.
Right.
Okay, and let's hope, oh, there it is, okay? So my report ran, as you can see, 33 seconds, okay? I cheated, and I'm admitting you that I cheated, because what I actually was doing already, this was a pre-cached report, okay? If I don't run this report pre-cached, it's going to run for 1.5 minutes. I don't want to bring that in front of a phone room, okay? So what happens is the following, okay? We're going to now create what we call a column store index, the way we have it in SQL Server 2012, and then we're going to take that over to the way we have it in SQL Server 2014. Okay? So let's have a look at that. Going to open a script here, column store indexing. So what I can do is I'm going to use my data warehouse, and just for the record and give you some insights here on that data warehouse that I have, my retail data warehouse, it's keeping fact of my online sales. If I look at the properties of that table and I look at the storage, okay, that table has a little over 12 million records and has a current storage of 472 megabytes. Put things in perspective, I'm running this from my laptop, so let's see what happens when I create a column store index. Now, same concept, right? I create a column store index. It is a non-clustered column store index. And the way that works is create index statement, non-clustered column store index, right? So what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna create that index, select everything here, and I hit execute. Now, of course, what I could have done is I could use Management Studio. I can right click on that table here, actually expand and go to indexes, and I can create that non-column store, a non-clustered column store index using my graphical interface as well, okay? So currently I only have a primary key on that. I'm running my create index statement, and that basically ran 27 seconds. What I do at that point is I'm processing every row, and this is a really good example, okay? How many of you are from Oakland? Okay, wow. Can you imagine if I need to go and fetch in each and every one of you? That's gonna be a disaster, right? This is my row store right now. What I'm doing with my column store is I'm flipping this into rows, and I'm gonna move everyone from Oakland into the same row, everyone from Wellington into the same row, anyone from Belgium? Okay, and I'm gonna move myself into a row as well, right? So that is basically what happens. Now, because of that, I have much better compression. Much better compression means less storage, right? Now, I'm going to look back at that table here and say, hey, give me the properties of that table and look at the storage. You'll see that my table now is 676 megabytes. And the key reason for that is because I built a non-clustered index on top of a clustered one, okay? What is my performance benefit going to be? What if I run that report again? How fast is it going to run?
1 second.
1 second? That would be acceptable performance, wouldn't it? Let's see how fast it runs, okay? 0.1 seconds. Now, it's not pre-cached. I can actually show you DBCC, clean my buffers, and run it again. You'll see that it's not pre-cached, okay? So it's not pre-cached because I'm using a different execution plan because I have a column store index in place. Now, if you use column store indexes in SQL Server 2012, the key problem is it puts the table into read-only mode, okay? There's some workarounds with this where you could go into partition switching and so on, but we actually went further with SQL Server 2014. And what we're doing in 2014 is slightly different. Now, in order to save us some time, what I actually did is I created that same table with a clustered column store, okay? If I look in the properties of that table, you'll see that my table storage now is 207 megabytes. Why? Because I'm not storing it in a row store anymore. I'm actually storing it in a column store with compression, much better compression because I now work on a column store basis.
So single clustered index for the
single
column store, right?
Clustered columnar index.
Absolutely.
Okay, so we're moving to a pure columnar store. And again, you know how to do this. I can use Management Studio. I can use my Transact SQL syntax. Or
what about non-clustered indexes, Standy?
Advantage of that. Yeah, I could still put, I can still put non-clustered indexes, but there's really no need to at that point. Now, what I'm going to do is, and the people that were questioning before, hey, is this cached or non-cached? What I'm actually going to do now is I'm actually going to rename the table, okay? And rather than renaming the table now, so just do a table rename so I don't need to change my report definition to the other report. So what I'm going to do is now is I will refresh my report, okay? And it got even faster, 0.16 seconds, okay? That's pretty impressive. I'm doing joins over a table that has over 12 million records, and I build the report with a nice cloud background. And I get that result in less than a second, okay? If you look at some of our customers, and one of the customers I worked with was a telco company, rather than having complaints from customers calling and saying, hey, my daughter sent 12,000 text messages, that's impossible, I'm not paying that invoice, they can live at that point say and point out to the call data record and say, well, sir, here's the report with the call data records. She did send 11,000 records, 11,000 text messages. Okay? I'm a little concerned because I have a daughter as well. She does not have a cell phone yet.
So, Dandy, just to be clear, we can run inserts, updates, and deletes against this
table? Yeah, so
this
at this
table?
Point, not only is that table now a cluster, that actually also is fully updatable. So many more benefits to that point as well. And we could probably talk about that later and drill down into those capabilities as well. Okay, so far, column store indexing. Now, if we look at another feature that really takes us to those in-memory benefits, we showed you column store indexing. If you look at it from a storage-based perspective, again, for the matter of the presentation, we're actually showing you the difference. What if I have a table that has some custom indexes? My little table was like 20 gigs. That table now with a clustered column store, pure, no additional indexes, 1.8 gig. Okay? And faster performance. So we put you a slide up there that has a comparison on what that would do if you use compression, if you use table with page compression. So those kind of options are in there. Now, when we think about security, go ahead, this is yours.
So let me talk a little bit about security. So the first thing I want to call out, and I think that we can justifiably be genuinely proud of SQL Server in this space, is least vulnerable database 5 years in a row. You'll see this from this National Institute of Standards and Technology. So, I mean, this really is a number to be very happy with, to be very proud about. I'm personally very pleased to see it. You look at the graph here for 2013, zero attacks. It's really a great thing to see. It's very cool. We started a long time ago. That whole security push was quite a number of years ago now, and we're now starting to see these kind of benefits coming through. So that's fantastic. Related to that, CC certifications, transparent data encryption, which we've had for a while now, and something very interesting that's happened with encryption key management, which is the capability or the facility to take your encryption keys and store them on a different machine. Because one of the key conversations that comes up when we talk about encryption is how much should the DBA know? Should the DBA have access to the keys to encrypt these databases? And that's one of these classic conversations that's been going on a long time in the industry, is how much responsibility should the DBA actually take in terms of the knowledge of key management for those databases.
So in my opinion, DBA shouldn't have no access to the database, right? That's my
opinions differ, so let's be clear.
I mean, can you imagine if anyone is here with a colleague in the room and you're the DBA and you would be able to get access to, you're the DBA, you're sysadmin, and you can get access to any data that sits within the company? There's something wrong with that.
Yeah. It's a huge responsibility, right?
And some security mechanisms in the United States probably had some experience with that in the past, right? Now,
I think we should move on, Dandy.
now, what else we did is there's something in there that says enhanced separation of duty. And I think we have a next slide on that if you want to look at that. So enhanced separation of duty, which means we can create server-based roles on which we can give access to people that need to be able to optimize indexes, that need to be able to take a backup of a database, that look at permissions, that look at things like query execution plans and so on, without giving them access to the data.
Similarly with profiler, troubleshooting,
performance thing, troubleshooting. All those tools will work. Yeah. You don't need to be a sysadmin. You can be a full DBA, do everything you want, except getting access to the user data. Okay, so getting access and select from tables, for example. Okay, which is actually a great mechanism for some of the other roles, right? Actually a great mechanism for system-centered integration, that you can now create a user account just for system-centered reporting without that account being used to actually get access to data
It's a good feature. All right, let's talk a little bit about scalability with respect to SQL Server 14. So just quickly, you can read from the slide quite happily. It tells you the number of logical processes and so on, and what we've done in terms of memory management for virtual machines.
So how many of you run SQL Server in a virtualized environment? Okay. 95% of the SQL servers running within Microsoft, which is one of the largest IT organizations on the planet, 95% of the SQL servers run virtualized. Okay? On Hyper-V, of course, that is.
How many are running on Hyper-V?
Don't ask. So we're not going to ask that question.
I didn't ask that question.
The great thing is, if you look on the enhancements and the combination with Windows Server 2012 R2 there, is we're taking advantage of a lot of capabilities. Okay, one of them being, I think there's a click there. Let's click there. Okay, one of the fact that we can online resize the VHD files, we can take advantage of network and storage quality of service. We can also take advantage of some of those new features like storage spaces and NIC teaming. Mm-hmm. And basically, you can define storage across multiple spaces. There's a couple of Windows Server sessions on that. What I think is one of the most significant things that I play with is the capability to now use resource governors,
to manage
not only on the CPU or the memory, but also on I/O. I can control I/O.
So this is something that I've seen, Dandy, with quite a number of customers in New Zealand, is a bit of a reluctance to use Resource Governor because of that exact missing capability. So this is something that's here in SQL 14, is the ability to constrain I/O based on resource pools. And if you think of what that can do for you, that's quite a significant feature.
Okay. So one of the other things we talked about is that SSD buffer pool extension that we mentioned. And again, if you know SQL Server, you know how to do SSD buffer pool. So how about you show us that, Pat, and let's have a look at that.
Sure. So let's go in and look at that. So what we have sitting in here, SSD buffer pool extension. So let's take you very quickly through this. So the concept is you take typically an SSD drive and you use that drive as an extension to your SQL Server buffer pool. So most of you are SQL Server people, 3/4 of the people in the room, you're used to the buffer pool. SQL Server is reading data from disk, placing it in the buffer pool, and then accessing it from the buffer. So what we have here is a capability to extend the size of that buffer pool by flushing out part of that buffer pool to an extension or to an SSD drive. And that is for clean data only. So you're not going to lose data. It's not going to store any pages that have been changing, that have been changed or changing. So think of that as a read cache. We typically suggest round about 1 in 16 in terms of the size of that SSD buffer pool to your max memory for a SQL Server. So this is a huge benefit. And if you were going to do this, there's an alter server statement here that will turn on this capability. And what you see a file name. The file exists, so we can turn this off. We've left that turned on, so what we're going to have to do is turn it off, and I'm hoping that this file will then go away.
It will go away.
And then we can come and run it again. And this has put the file back. So that file now exists. It has the name that you see there. It has that size. It's ready to go. It can be used by the buffer pool. If we want to check, is this feature enabled? Is it actually working? It came back and said command successful, but we want to just double check. What is the current size of that SSD pool in kilobytes? And is it actually up and running? Yes, we can see it's running. Turning it on really is that simple. We can have a little bit of a dive into that, look at the number of pages and so on that are in the buffer pool. What I'm not going to show you, what I had separately, but because of time constraints, is actually changing max memory down to a very small number so that you can constrain the memory that SQL Server has. And then when you use this feature, you'll see pages actually moving into that buffer pool extension. And it's quite interesting to see which pages and which databases. And I was quite interested to see that myself. So when I actually had a look at that, I wrote a couple of queries. You won't see them here because we've got a lot of memory. Did I say that Dandy had a lot of memory on his laptop? I think I mentioned that, right? So what you'll see the different database IDs and whether those pages have actually migrated into the buffer pool or not. And when I was working with this, what I saw, which I found interesting, I mentioned it to Dandy, is the first database that seemed to be migrated, because you don't have access to this algorithm, you can't tune it, you just enable it or disable it, was the resource database. That's the one that started to migrate. And then as you put pressure on the system, pages are moving in and out from your queries and your user databases into this buffer pool extension. So this is a great feature. And lastly, if you really want to go down a little bit further, you can also run a query from the this DMV here, system OS performance counters, and look for the performance counters that relate to the use of the buffer pool. So what you see here is you won't see many numbers because I haven't put any stress on the system, but you can see how many pages are in this pool, how many have been evicted, how many have been allocated, how many are free, and how much are in use as a percentage. So although you can't directly influence the way that store is balanced, you can monitor very clearly how it's being used at any particular point in time. So simple demo, but I think the ability to extend your buffer pool in a simple and safe way is a good feature.
So Pat,
I'll be talking to you later,
so,
Rob.
So I'm going to repeat that for recordings.
So he's from Wellington. So
the Commodore, right? Pat does not need any more memory in this machine. Well, give him an SSD. I got one in my bag somewhere.
Once again, we're going to move on. All right.
So one of the other things we did is, and this is really a pure enterprise enhancements that we're bringing there, is in SQL Server, pre-SQL Server 2014, when you had a partition table and you also partitioned your indexes, when you were performing online index operations, actually we were blocking down that entire index partition. So what you can do now, well, actually that entire partitioning across the table, what you can do now in SQL Server 2014 is we switch that over to a model that is managing the lock priority for table switching functions, but also giving you single partition online index rebuild, which is significant in larger data warehouses or larger OLTP systems. Okay, so what else we got?
Okay, BI.
Now, why do we store data? Why, right? I mean, we have a lot of things that we store operational, but there's also a lot of things that we store to get business insights into our data, okay? So what we did is we looked at the capabilities on how we can enhance things and bring you powerful insight capabilities that we put where it makes the most sense behind the scenes, using things that you're already familiar with, using the Power Pivot model, and bring enhancements into that to bring what we call an entire and a complete BI platform. Okay, so let's have a look on what we're actually doing there. Can you click? Thanks. So how many of you use Excel? Some people just don't want to raise their hand because I think that would be a stupid question. Most people use Excel, right? Now, what we see is within Excel, a lot of people start using that for pivot tables and so on, or to get data from different kind of data sources. And they want to combine that and bring an experience that allows you to discover those data sources and merge and bring them together before you actually start doing analysis on that data. So what we did when we announced Power BI, and we announced that earlier this year, is we have a full offering within Office 365 that allows you to do your authoring of your BI capabilities in Excel, and then bring that into a collaborative effort by sharing that out onto SharePoint online and taking the advantage of the collaboration experience that you have there. We even went to a model where you can query your database in a natural language and do data queries in natural language using those Power BI capabilities. And if you worked with SQL Server before, this is so much more than English query as we had it in SQL 2000. This is really natural language taking advantage of all the capabilities and everything that we do in the Power Pivot model. Now we want to bring that into an experience where we want to give you the capability to browse that on any kind of device. Could you go get some napkins, Pat? Like, can we have some napkins somewhere? Do they have napkins in the back?
They
check?
Do, they do.
Okay. I need it for my demo, so. So let's have a look on some of those capabilities. Okay. So I'm going to switch to this one. Okay, so I have Excel. Is that coming? I have Excel. As I said, I have Excel. I have Excel. You guys just want to see it.
You don't. What number are you on? You're on two.
Okay, no, so how two. About, hey, we have failover, don't we?
We do.
Okay, let's do this. Okay. As I said, we're going to go to one here, and I said, I have Excel. They're coming up. I have Excel.
Always on okay,
just
practice,
a little bit, right? Little bit tougher here. So I have Excel. Yay. So what I can do now is I can go to Power Query and I can bring in data from any kind of data source that I can potentially get data from. Okay? Data sources that are not necessarily SQL Server. Let me have a look at that number two, see if we can get that on. So what else I can do is I can go from any kind of database. It could be Windows Azure SQL Database, SQL Server, and so on. I can even go to Facebook and let's say, hey, let's figure out what Dandy puts on his Facebook page. Okay. More realistically, you're probably interested into what gets put onto your corporate Facebook page and what likes, and if you announce a new product feature, what people say about that. So I can go to Facebook and I can look at some of the queries that I have here using my Facebook API. There's nothing offensive. There's just a couple of things that are in Dutch because it's my Facebook page. But one of the things I do is I can now do sentiment analytics and I can actually start drilling down into that data. One of the things you see me doing, I say happy birthday a lot. First thing I do in the morning is I look at my Facebook page and say happy birthday to people. And I see whether they like that or not. If they don't like it, I will unfriend them on the next rotation. So
wow.
The great thing about this is I can actually say, hey, I want to figure out a bit more about that data. And I want to see when that was created, who it was from, hit OK on that one. And you can really expand and all these data sets, okay? And it's going to import that. Now, this import could take a while because it is browsing my entire Facebook page. And recently, when I make some comments on non-Microsoft products, there's a lot of people that take that very personal. I'm actually running an experiment on that. Now, the great thing about this is once that I'm done, I get that data set in and I have that imported, I can take that data set and publish that into my Power Pivot model. Once that I'm in Power Pivot, I can then grab that data and publish that workbook onto a SharePoint BI site and start using it from there. Okay? So that data will start loading. Now, a few other things I can do is I can go to that Power Query at the same time and say, I want to do things like online searches. Okay? I am in New Zealand. So a lot of men dressed in black this morning, yesterday morning, so I decided to do the same for breakfast. They just had a little more muscle than I had, but I want to find out things about rugby, okay? So what I can do here is I can do an online search and find out things about rugby. Okay, history of rugby, domestic competition. Okay, who won when? Let's not go there.
So let me just be clear, Dandy. You're coming to New Zealand, and on stage, you're going to talk about rugby.
Let's talk about something.
I just want to clarify
well, that. Let's talk about something that I'm more familiar with, being from Belgium. Let's look at beer consumption. Consumption per capita. Okay, so what I can do now is I get that beer consumption. I get the list of countries by beer consumption per capita. Okay, I can pull that in. And I see all these countries and their consumption in liters. Okay, what else I can do is I can actually now go to that Power Query again, do another online search and say like, hey, there's a difference between beer consumption and overall alcohol consumption. Right? Some beers, depending on what country we live, really doesn't have any alcohol in it. So let's look at alcohol consumption and pull that information in there because I'm going to release a new product, deciding which country I'm going to release it and where I'm going to be the most successful in the countries where people ring the most, right? So what else I can do is I can also look at other things like, hey, what about tea consumption? Okay, maybe I want to do an alcoholic tea or something. So I could combine that. And the great thing about this Power Query is I'm now pulling data in from multiple data sources. You'll see there's a couple of options here. I get data that I'm actually pulling in from Wikipedia. And so what I get there is I pull that in, format it, I can refresh it, and I can publish it. And then, of course, I will be able to take that into a Power View workbook that I can now have directly within Excel by saying here is insert, I want to insert a Power View, okay? Now, one of the other things when we talk about visualizations, and I have a separate breakout session tomorrow afternoon, I'm gonna get together with Peter Myers, is a new visualization that we brought into Excel, which is called Power Map. Now, Power Map is quite impressive, okay? Basically, because I see this map here and it looks at my table and says, hey, list of countries by beer consumption per capita. There we go. There's the countries. Automatically detects you had a country in your Power Pivot model. So now I can map that and I can even do the map labels so I can actually see what country I'm in. Now, the great thing about this, and that's actually what I wanted to show you on that device there, is that it's fully touch friendly. So I can really scroll around. I can zoom in, okay? And I can really use touch capabilities that I have, which I don't have on my failover laptop that I'm using here. But what I can do is I can go next here. I can then say, okay, what I wanted to see is I wanted to see the consumption per capita, okay? And I see that coming in. Now, what I wanted to see is not, I actually wanted to see a region, okay? So actually I could color in those countries. Now the great thing about this is I can actually add an additional layer to it and start overlaying multiple kind of data sets on top of each other and then do my visualization that way. Okay. Good thing about this, we actually announced the release candidate of Power Map today. You can download that and start playing with that yourself. Now, what's really cool about this, it's kind of like playing with Windows Movie Maker. You can add a scene to it. You can say that, hey, on this one, I want to start drilling down into a specific country. Okay. I can even go locate the countries if I really don't know where they are by using that find button or that find location. I could flip to a flat map model, or I can create a video out of this. So I can do my BI insights. I can do things like, hey, I want to have a 2D chart with that as well. Okay. I can then say I want to make annotations on each of those data points. 71 liters in New Zealand. That's quite some, actually. Mm-hmm. We should map that and overlay that with some other information. But the great thing about this is once that I'm done with this, I can create a video or I can do what we call play a tour. And that tour will then really give me a full graphical representation of my data, zoom into the details, overlay those maps, and I can really build my story together. So some really great visualizations that are sitting right in there. Now, we're not going to run out of time. We're close, though. What else I can do is I might not be as smart on how to build this and how to do so. So what about natural language query? Okay. Show sales. Okay. That's going to show me my sales. Now, this is a restaurant bar data. I can actually look and
say that was like, you last night, right?
No, it wasn't. list bartenders. Okay. So I can have a list of my bartenders, but I can also really do some great representation on something like sales per weekday. So this is natural language query that leverages that same model out of my BI capabilities, and it's going to show me sales per weekday and it's actually going to pull that in and generate me the chart that actually does and gets all that data together. Okay, so great capabilities right there. If I want to have a different visualization, and I want to say like, hey, you know what, give me that visualization in a pie chart, I can actually do so. The great thing about this, you did not build any report. The only thing you did is you uploaded that Power Pivot workbook onto that Power BI site, and you could start leveraging that. Now, Pat is pointing me that I'm also almost out of time. We talked about bringing that experience onto any kind of device, right? I'm gonna see if I can use this device at all. A little scared on this one. Whether that's coming through. It is number 6 there. And it is coming through. I'm gonna try not to touch it. Okay. But I have that same experience, as I said, on any device. So I can go to that site, I can look at my reports, I can drill down and visualize
them. What's that device you've got there?
It's an HTML5 device. So any HTML5 device will actually support those capabilities as well. Okay, let's go back to our presentation there. So that was Power BI. Breakdown session tomorrow afternoon. Slides. Let me click through this. So I showed you the discover and combine. It's all based on the Power Pivot model. We can display that using Power View capabilities, or we can visualize that. And we're going to drill down into the session on that tomorrow when we go into Power Map. Really visualize that data, map that out, and then we're going to start digging using touch capabilities. If I publish that onto a Power BI site, I can really combine everything together. I now will have the possibility to put featured questions and do that Q&A using the natural language query as I showed you. And as I showed you as well, I could put that on any HTML device. Now, we actually have a native application for Windows 8 devices, and whether that runs on a Surface RT or a Surface Pro or any other Windows device doesn't really matter. It's a full Power BI app that allows you to then connect to that site and browse through the reports. I'll drill down on that tomorrow as well. Which takes us to the hybrid cloud on things that we have quite a couple of sessions on how to optimize SQL Server in a virtual machine. An easy ramp onto cloud. Now, I know Pat is jumping here because he wants to show you guys a really cool demo, which is where I go. I have a session, The Future of the DBA, tomorrow morning. We're going to talk about your future and things that you need to pay attention to and focus on. And cloud, embracing the cloud, is definitely one of those capabilities that you should look into. Pat, I think we only have 1 minute for a demo. Do you think you can do that?
We can do that.
Okay, let's have a look at that. So what Pat is going to show you is a feature that is available in SQL Server 2012 already. You can actually leverage storage space on Windows Azure. And so the cool thing about this is actually creating a credential.
So let me talk about that. This is my credential, so I hope nobody in the room's got a really good memory or a very fast scripting device or a camera.
Or looks at the recording and uses it afterwards.
Yeah, exactly. So what I did, very simply, I went to my Azure account, and you add some storage for yourself, and then once you've added some storage, you just select the storage option on the portal. Now I've got some storage. Then you create something called a container. And once you've done that, the portal will generate some keys for you. And this is the key that you see here. So you copy and paste that key, having done those two things on the portal, and you're now able to create a credential using the T-SQL that you see here. Once you have a credential, you can then run the backup database command using that credential. That's it. So this database will now get backed up to the cloud. So I've now not only got the backup of my database on the cloud, but there are also some geo capabilities in that store where you can have that backup replicated to other locations. So it's really quite significant from risk mitigation perspective, and it's a very easy thing to do. So having said that, let's see if this actually flies. So I'm going to drop my credential that I created, and I'm going to recreate it. So this part I definitely expect to fly. So I have a credential. Now that I have a credential, this is going to try and connect out to the internet. You'll notice that there are some little differences. The init option, for example, is not supported. It's using format. So if you need to recreate or overwrite that backup, that's the option that you need. So there are some subtle and some slight differences in terms of the backup options that are supported. But it's very straightforward and to run a backup. So let's check whether that actually works and goes out and backs up my database. And we can carry on talking while it's...
There we go. So backup to cloud gives you a lot of capabilities, right? Because you could use that to initialize. If you look at some of the other capabilities that we will be drilling down in tomorrow, is automatic movement of a database to Windows Azure using a wizard, or moving them to a Windows Azure virtual machine. So you have some capabilities there. Now, from a timing perspective, there's so many more things that we're going to be showing you across multiple breakouts that we have going on this week. As far as this session, there's one quick note that I do want to make, though.
You need to be on this machine.
And let me go back to that machine. And switch back to number 7 here. SQL Server 2014 CDP is available. You can download that. You can actually spin that up on Windows Azure as well. If you want to play around with some of those Power BI capabilities, you can register for preview. We give you a tenant. You can start building your own portals and so on. Related content, we did not fill that out because I think it's significant enough for you to look at that mini guide and look at every single session that you have on DBI. So last thing that lasts this is make sure you complete an eval. If there's any way that there's verbal feedback that you could provide us, we gladly take it. What I would put in there, if I were you, is a statement that says, if I would be sharing out my Azure storage key, I can imagine that my manager does not want to buy me more memory for my laptop. So with that, thanks everyone.
You're not going to get invited back, Tandy.
Have a wonderful week, and we'll be around for questions at any time.